Grace and peace be multiplied to you through the knowledge of God and our Lord Jesus Christ. Welcome. Today we'll be looking at He came to bring us into the Father. He came to bring us into the Father. Hallelujah. The Lord Jesus Christ came to bring us into the Father. We'll be looking at John chapter 14. Actually, there are a lot of mysteries in John chapter 14. And we're only looking at is maybe just one of the great mysteries in John 14. Remember John 14, 15, 16, 17, were the valedictory speeches and prayers of our Lord Jesus Christ before he ended his earthly ministry. So, he said a lot of profound things. He actually even said in John 16 that what he was saying, that he still had a lot to say, but the disciples could not comprehend it, obviously, because at that period, no one had been born of God. The Spirit of God was not having a permanent abode in any man. So it was going to be very hard to comprehend the divine truth he was bringing. So we're looking at he came to bring us into the Father. If you ask someone today, maybe a Christian, a believer, definitely, that what's the mission of the Lord Jesus Christ coming to us, I'm sure that the popular answer will not actually be that actually Christ came to bring us into the Father. And that's part of the mysteries he was telling the disciples, or he said in John chapter 14. So he said, the chapter started with that, believe in God and believe also in me, that in my Father's house there are many abodes. And part of what we'll be looking at today, I said, if you are not so, I will have told you that it's that word abode. In some translation, or popularly in some of the translation, it was put there that in my Father's house there are many mansions. But actually, we learned that the original Greek context actually said in my Father's house there are many abodes, many dwelling places. And it's the same word we learned was used in John chapter 2 when he went to the temple and he was with holy anger driving out everyone by stealing in house of God. And he said that if they destroy the temple, that in 3 days he will bring it back. And the temple he was referring to was himself. So himself was the temple in John chapter 2, his body, which he said after 3 days he'll bring it back. And that was the same word that was used in John chapter 14. And it was translated as mansions, but at least we give credit to the translators of the Bible. They did an awesome, great job. The Lord used them greatly, mightily, because it's been of tremendous blessing to us. And we're also grateful for them that in certain instances, when they weren't sure of the words to use, they actually italicized it, meaning to say that, hey, we added this word there because this is what grammatically sounds correct or something, or some, so that in the future, when anyone is reading it, they would know that, okay, this was not in the original context, or the translators actually added it to make it maybe more grammatical. But at least from a lot of Bible scholars, that word actually should be that in my Father's house, there are many abodes, there are many dwelling places. And there are a lot of scriptures in the New Testament to actually corroborate that, because he actually said in himself that he was going to a place, and the place he was going to, he mentioned it in John 13 verse 3, that Jesus being come from God and was going to God. Also in John 14, he mentioned it in that same John 14 verse 12, that he was going to the Father. John 14, 28, that he was going to the Father. John 16 verse 5, he was going to the Father. John 16 verse 10, he was going to the Father. John 16 verse 17, he was going to the Father. So it's almost everywhere that he mentioned it, that he was going to the Father. So it was the Father he was going to, but he was going through the death and his resurrection, that he actually, the destination was a person. The destination of where he was going to from that John chapter 14 was not a place per se, but a person, the person of the Heavenly Father. So that was where he was going. So it's good for us to set that foundation, that from scriptures, that, and actually other scriptures to corroborate that, actually will be from 1 Timothy chapter 3 verse 15. 1 Timothy chapter 3 verse 15, because the Bible actually defines whatever terminology that is being used in any context. So 1 Timothy chapter 3 verse 15 talks about the fact that the house of God, which is the church of the living God. And of course, the church of God is the body of Christ, which is his body that he was talking about. So we believe that those scriptures were given to corroborate exactly what he said in John 14, that the place he was going to was not a place, but not a physical location, but a being of the Heavenly Father. I'm going to prepare a place for you. So where he was preparing for us was the place in the Father, because in his Father there are many abodes in there, that where I am, that you may be also. Because he was in the Father. He is in the Father, and he was, so somebody might ask, how do you reconcile that? He says that he's in the Father in John 14:10, that I am in the Father and the Father is in me. That and he's saying that he's going to the Father. How can you be in the Father and you're going to the Father? And if you look at it from the standpoint that in the Lord Jesus Christ is divinity and humanity. The divinity is the after the Son of God, and the humanity, the Son of Man. Divinity, the Son of God was already in the Father, and the Father was in him. But his human aspect, of course, he had to become a man like you and I. That way he could die for us. There's no way he could do that except the Word becoming flesh. So the humanity was yet to be in the Father. So through death and resurrection, he brought his humanity into the Father. And that humanity actually included myself, yourself, the as many that have believed in him. So that's how he was able to bring us into the Father. So just in case there's a young believer out there struggling that I can't understand this, because you're going to the Father and you say you're in the Father, it's because the divinity is in the Father already, but the humanity is yet to be brought in the Father. That's why he said, I'm going to prepare a place for you. The place he was talking about was the Heavenly Father himself. God the Father is a dwelling place, a realm. We see that in other slides. Where was the place he was going to? Is the place a person or a location? We've established that the place is actually a person, not a physical location. John 14 is a very mysterious chapter. Although someone might ask, that does it mean that we don't have mansions or houses in heaven, or like it's been popularly been interpreted here? Yes, I would say that if you're going to refer to that, it's better to use the scripture of 2 Corinthians chapter 5. 2 Corinthians chapter 5 verse 1 and 2. Maybe in that context, yes, you might be referring to that. But when we're looking at John 14, the place he was going to was actually the Father. His goal was to bring us into the Father. So somewhere in my head, the Lord Jesus Christ came for a lot of reason. He came to do a lot of things in so many quarters. He came to set the captives free. He came to be our ransom. He came to give us his life. There's a lot of things that, of course, scripturally they were right. But personally, in my opinion, I believe one of the greatest things that he had, his mission, was to bring us into the Father. Because he himself was dwelling in the Father. And there is no dwelling like God. There's no abode. There's no dwelling place like the Heavenly Father. There is no more secure place than the Father himself, as Moses said in Psalm 90, that, oh God, you have been our dwelling place. Also Psalm 91 as well, he that dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, is my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I will trust. So the Father is a dwelling place, and actually he desires that all his children will make him their dwelling place. So what a joy. The destination was a person and not a place. And also the way to the Father was also a person and not a route. The way was a person. And the way is the Lord Jesus Christ himself. He said it in John 14:6, that I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father except by me. And he also said it in 1 Peter chapter 3 verse 14, that Christ, who also once died for sin, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God. So he is the one that is the way to bring us into the Father. There is no habitation like the Father. There's no more secure place than the Father. What a joy that as believers in Christ Jesus, the realm we are living, the place we are actually living in spiritually, and actually if your faith carries it physically as well, that our dwelling place is the Father. So when men ask us that, where are you dwelling? I think it's scripturally correct to say that I am, that my dwelling place is the Father. Oh, where's your postal or your resident, your permanent residential address? The Heavenly Father. Because that address in the realm of the spirit and physical, God is everywhere. So what a joy. Wherever we're going to, we know that we are living in the Father. That the Father is our abode. The Father was the destination, and the way was us, the Lord himself. No one comes to the Father but by me, in John 14:6. His mission was to bring us to where he was, no other than the Father. So where he was in the Father. So he pretty much was telling us that, look, a lot of things I'm doing, like he said in John 14, that believe me for the very works, that the words that I speak, that it is the Father that dwells in him that does the work. So the same level of the way he was operating, it was a God-man. God the Father was walking through him. So that was the same that was the same position he wanted to get us into, that, hey, I'm able to do all these signs, wonders, and miracles on the earth here because I'm living in the Father and the Father is living in me. What you're saying in me is exactly what I want to be replicated upon my death and resurrection. I can't bring you to where I'm living. I can't bring you to the abode of the Father where I am, except I go through death and resurrection. John 12:24, except the grain of wheat fall to the dying, it abides by itself, but if it dies, it produces many grain. I have to go through death and resurrection, then I can bring you to where I am, and the Father will continue the work, and I will continue, because the Trinity are one. The Trinity are one. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. 1 John 5:7, that there are three that bear record in heaven. The Father, the Word, the Holy Ghost, these three are one. So they are always working in unison. But there's a different, there's a video lesson on that as well, as God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. You might get more on that there. So, for Christ also suffered once for sin, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God. 1 Peter 3:18. So, where he was, his intention was to bring us into the Father. And it's a mystery, because in John 6:44, the scripture says that no one can come to me except the Father draws them. That the Father is bringing people to Christ. That's his goal, to bring people, sinners, believers, to draw us closer to Christ. And when we are brought to Christ, Christ in turn now bring us into the Father. Because 2 Corinthians 5 says it as well, that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself. So because the Father is dwelling in Christ, so he's bringing people to Christ. And Christ also is bringing people to the Father. It's a mystery, a mutual abode, what the Trinity are doing. It's a great, great mystery. This Psalm 91, that he that dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord is my refuge and my fortress. What a joy. No one can come to the Father except the Father. No one can come to me except the Father draws him. So the Father is drawing people to Christ, and Christ in turn is now bringing them into the Father, so that the Father will be our abode. The Father draws people to Christ. Christ in turn brings people into the Father. What a joy. What a joy. What a joy. It says, greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. So it's a mutual abode. The Father was not just God's plan in eternity past, or the divine plan of the Trinity in eternity past, was not that man or the children of God, the saints of God, the sons and daughters of God, that it's not just for us to receive God as our life, to receive the life of God, but the Father also had the intention that we will actually be living in them. So in and out we are covered. We are living in the Father, and the Father is living in us. Oh, hallelujah. If he came to get us into the Father, this means man was created to live in the Father. So God's intention is that man was created to live in the Father. A fish cannot really survive outside of water, because that's the natural habitation that has been created by the Creator for it. So same way for us as humans as well. Yes, some of them might say, but others are living, not everyone is living by Father. But in the eyes of God, they are truly not living. There's no way a human will be able to fulfill their mandate, their destiny from God, without living in the Father. Because if the Lord Jesus Christ said he came to get us where he was, that means there's no more secure place than in the Father, and there's no way we can fulfill our destiny except the Father comes in us and we are actually living in the Father. It's just a joy, it's a marvel, it's a wonderful thing to be in the Father. Also, this is Acts chapter 17:28, for in him we live and move and have our being. So the Father is the divine Trinity. When we talk about the Father, when we use the word Father, is not one third of the Godhead. The Son is not one third of the Godhead. The Holy Spirit is not one third of the Godhead. They walk in unison. The three are one. In 1 John 5:7, I quoted earlier, and God has said it all through his word, that here, O Israel, the Lord your God is one. Is one. In Deuteronomy 6:4, Isaiah 45:5 also says that as well. I am the Lord your God, and beside me there is no God. So we have one God, but we have him as the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. So when we are mentioning in him, God uses singular and plural, and it's just a marvel, a wonderful thing about the God who we serve. So when it says we are living in him we live, we move and have our being, that means we are living in the divine Trinity. What a joy, what a joy. So when you go out, when you and I go out to the marketplace or wherever we are, whether we are ministering, we are in any walk of life the Lord has called us to, there is just a confidence in us that I am not alone. I am in the Father and the Father is in me. I am in the Son is in me. I am in the Spirit is in me. Through His incarnation, He brought God into man. So through His incarnation, He brought God into man, and that without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifest in the flesh. 1 Timothy 3:16. God became a man. The Word became flesh. 1 John 1:1 and John 1:14. So He brought God into man. Then that is His incarnation. But in through His death and resurrection, He was able to bring man. That is the saints of God. The sinners are not in the Father. This is just exclusively for those who have accepted the Lord Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. He now brings us into the Father through His death and resurrection. There is no way under heaven we can be in the Father except He had gone through death and resurrection. So what a joy, what a joy. As His believers, our real address is just God the Father. So our real address is just God the Father. It's not a physical house, it's not a physical location. Yes, that's just a shadow, but the reality is that we are actually living in the Father. So that's why each time we meet one another, there's this, the Word of God say, in lowliness of mind, let each esteem each other, let us esteem each other as better than ourselves. We should esteem one another, because each time we are relating with our fellow saints of God, it's always important to not just see them as just another human being, but to see them that I'm actually dealing with Christ, I'm dealing with the Father, I'm dealing with the Holy Spirit, because they are living in the Father, I am living in the Father, and the Father is living in them, and the Father is living in me. So there's just a sense of reverence. We don't worship them, we don't make any human being an object of worship. That belongs to the Godhead, the Deity. But there's just a respect. He said that we should honor all men. There's just a respect. There's just, like Paul said, say, I know no man after the flesh. It just makes us humble to one another. What a joy that our physical address, our real address, that address, there's no way we can, I pray that no one gets himself out of the Father. So whether we are asleep, we are actually still living in the Father, and the Father is living in us. When we are awake, the same thing, we are in the Father, and the Father is in us. He did not only bring us into the Father, He also brought the Father into us, a mutual abode. In Ephesians chapter 4, from verse 4 to 6, there's one Spirit, there's one body, there's one Spirit, there's one Lord, one baptism, one God, and one Father of all, who is in all. So He brought us into the Father, and also the Father also came into us. So as believers in Christ Jesus, we are not only living in the Father, the Father is also living in us. And a lot of this, you find it in the epistles. 1 John 4:13 is one, and in 1 John he actually said, everyone that confesses that Jesus is Lord, God is living in them and He is living in God. Oh, what a marvel. He says that no one can say that Jesus came in the flesh except by the Spirit of God, except God is in that person, in 1 John 4:1-2. So you could imagine that for us as believers, we are not just by ourselves. We are never alone. We are with the Lord. The Lord is with us, and the Lord is in us, and we are living in Him. This is a great mystery. There is no greater blessing than this. There's no greater blessing than this. Yes, God gives us all things to enjoy that pertain to life and godliness, but there is no greater blessing than living in the Father and having the Father living in us. And our prayers is just that God, and actually that's a lot of the prayers in the New Testament, that the eyes of our understanding may be enlightened to see the hope of His calling and the exceeding greatness of His power towards us, that we might receive the Spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of Him. Because the more we are aware of these great truths, the more we are able to walk in the reality. Just imagine, because there are so many deeper truths that about our Christian faith, about the Trinity, that we are yet to know. It's just as the Lord opens our eyes to it. But the more God opens our eyes to it, faith naturally just comes, because there's just a confidence, there's just a sense of aroma of Christ that we bring in every environment. We don't see ourselves, we don't see anything pertaining to us as just we alone, that we are not in this situation alone, we are not in this project, in this circumstance alone, that actually the divine Trinity, they are with us to give us the wisdom and also to walk their purpose through that situation. What a joy, what a joy. The Father is our abode, and at the same time, we are the abode of the Father. So in Isaiah 66:1-2, God had asked a very rhetorical question that, hey, that heaven is my throne, the earth is my footstool, which house would you build for me? Where is my resting place? But to this one will I look unto, the one that trembles at my word. And God asked that question, and we get to the New Testament and find out that, okay, we are actually the abode God was talking about, because 1 Corinthians 3 also says that we are the building of the Lord, the house of God. So you could imagine Hebrews 3 also says that as well. We are the house of God. God, who is the builder of all things. But so we could see from that angle that we are the abode of God, and God is our abode. It's just the divine making. It's impossible by any philosophical or any religion in the world whereby the followers are actually living in whatever they are worshiping. It's impossible. It's for us, even as humans, it's actually impossible to live in another person and having another person living in you. This is just exclusively for the saints of God, the children of God. It's a mystery. We can't use human words to describe it. Science cannot even fathom it. We are actually living in the Father, and the Father is living in us, only by the sheer grace of God and the sheer mercies of the Lord. Hallelujah to Christ. He came to bring us into the Father. I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father but by me, in John 14:6. In John 17:24, in John 14:15-16, he said a lot of things to the disciples. He knew they couldn't comprehend what he was saying. Then in John 17, he started praying and praying what he had actually told them, that what he had told them will become a reality. And this was part of the prayers he was saying there, that he prayed that, Father, I will that they also, whom thou have given me, may be where I am. And where was he? He was in no other place than in the Father. So you could see that the sum of the Lord Jesus Christ praying was that we should be where he was. And today that is a reality. As a saint of God, as a saint of God myself, we are living in the Father, because in the Father there are many abodes. I believe that's the greatest blessing under heaven. It's a joy, yes, wonderful thing to think about, going to, maybe when we die, we're going to heaven. But that is, I would say that is really, really less. And when compared to living in the Father, if the Father were to ask someone, where would you rather choose to live, in the Father or wait to get to heaven before you stay in the heaven? No, wherever the Father is heaven. So living in the Father is a greater blessing, because God could not wait for us to finish our assignment here on earth to meet him in heaven. But he has brought himself down, that while we are here on the earth, we are also living in him, and we stay in fellowship with him till our assignment here on earth is done. And of course, we transit to the new Jerusalem and to abode with the Trinity forever. What a joy. So in summary today, we've been able to look at the topic, he came to bring us into the Father, we said, and we're pretty much most of what we thought about was from John chapter 14, that the Father was where he was going. He said he was going to a place, and he was going to prepare a place for us. And we said the place he was going was not a physical location, but the Heavenly Father himself, because he repeated it several times that he was going to the Father. Also, other scriptures like 1 Timothy 3:15 says that the house of God, in 1 Timothy chapter 3 verse 15, that God's house, which is the church of the living God, the pillar and the ground of the truth. So the definition of the Father's house he was referring to in John 14 verse 2 was actually the Father's house, which is the church of the living God, in 1 Timothy 3. And also that same word was used also in John 14 as well, when he says that where those who love him, they will keep his commandments and they will obey his word, and he and the Father will make their abode. That was the same abode that was used earlier on in John chapter 14. So we said that he came to bring us into the Father, that there is no dwelling place like the Father. There is no more secure place under heaven than the Father, because and wherever we are, we as believers, we should be conscious of the fact that we are not just living in a physical location. We are not without a shelter. He said the Lord, that the Lord is a refuge for us, a tower of refuge. Could you imagine that we are actually living in the Father? In Psalm 91 verse 1 as well, that, oh Lord, you have been our dwelling place in the ages past. Also Psalm 91, he that dwells in the secret place of the Most High. So where he was getting us to was not a physical location per se, but a being, the being of the Father himself, because that was where he was dwelling in. He was living in the Father, and the Father was living in him, and that's how he was able to carry out all the assignment that the Father had for him. Actually, the Father was walking through him, and that's God's goal for us today. Philippians 2:13 says, it is God who walks in us both to will and to do for his good pleasure. So what a joy that where he came to bring us to was into the Father. There is no more secure place than the Father as well. And because as believers, we are the living epistles of God. We are the vessel of God. We are the containers of God. God's intention is that we are his house. We are his resting place. He finds satisfaction in us as his children. And so that's where he desires to be. He wants us to make him our abode. So wherever we are, there's just a sense of awareness that we are living in the Father. What a joy he came to bring us to the Father. Hallelujah to the all-inclusive Christ. He came to bring us into the Father. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.